feel like I should be doing something, saying something.
You don't have to do anything.
I'm waiting for the thumb.
I know, really. I'm just...
All right, here we go. Here we go. Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us here at Hyman Settlement School's Appalachian Writers Workshop for our closing event. My name is Silas House, and I'm a writer who has been involved with the workshop in some fashion for the past 25 years. Tonight, we celebrate two of our foundational writers, Jim Wayne Miller and James Steele, in our annual keynote. I encourage you to find out more about both Miller and Steele, and I'd personally direct you to read Miller's The Briar Sermon, which I think of as the best challenge to Appalachian people ever written, and also James Steele's River of Earth, truly an American classic and one of the all-time best child narrators. And Mr. Steele's daughter is here with us tonight, Teresa Reynolds. She's been so supportive of our work at Hyman Settlement School and carrying forth the legacy of James Steele. You can't see her on screen, but I want us to pay homage to her and thank her for all she's done for Appalachian literature. We appreciate you so much, Teresa. And as always, I thank you for the trust that you've put in me in carrying forth that legacy. Well, every year at Hyman, we pay homage to Miller and Steele. We want to honor them. They were close friends. And each year we do that by inviting a writer that we believe carries on their legacy in some way, particularly in ways of complexifying and representing our region. So our keynote speaker tonight certainly does that. If I told you all of Adriana Trigiani's accomplishments, we'd be here all night, so I'll just list a few. First of all, Adriana grew up in the small coal mining town of Big Stone Gap, Virginia. And after attending St. Mary's College in Indiana, she went to New York, where she acted off-Broadway, and before too long found herself writing scripts for the number one television show in the country, The Cosby Show, and its spinoff, A Different World, as well as many other shows, including writing a Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade and specials and series for the likes of, among others, Madeline Kahn, Lily Tomlin, and our queen of the mountains, Dolly Parton, who names Adri as one of her favorite writers. Fortunately for us, she eventually turned to novel writing, and in the year 2000 made her debut with the celebrated Big Stone Gap, the first book in her Appalachian quartet. She has published a book almost every year since, and her new one, The Good Left Undone, comes out in April of next year. Her books have appeared regularly on the New York Times bestseller list and other bestseller lists, have been published in 36 countries and read by millions of people. As if that is not enough, she directed the acclaimed documentary Queens of the Big Time in 1996 and made her feature film debut with an adaptation of her debut novel. The film of Big Stone Gap, starring Ashley Judd, Patrick Wilson, and Whoopi Goldberg, was released in 2015. And was one of the highest grossing romantic comedies that year, and was the highest grossing romantic comedy directed by a woman, so props to that. It was all filmed on location in Big Stone, and in my Appalachian film class, we look at it in particular for its diversity. It's rare that an Appalachian film contains characters who are immigrants, black, gay, Melungeon, but Adri did all of that in the film, showing our region as more diverse and complex than many filmgoers had ever seen it before. Since then, she's also directed Then Came You, which debuted as the number one comedy in the country when it came out last year. You may also recognize her from her regular appearances on The Today Show over the last 20 years. She also does remarkable work for us here in Appalachia. One of her biggest contributions is through the program she co-founded in 2013 with Nancy Fisher called The Origin Project, which is an in-school writing program that brings professional writers into the classroom to work with students on their creative writing skills, specifically stories inspired by their own family histories. The project culminates with a published anthology of student work at the end of the year. It now serves over 1,700 students, grades 2 through 12, in the Appalachian Mountains of Virginia. She is also active in many other organizations and service projects in both Appalachia and New York City, where she lives with her husband, daughter, and rescue pets. The first time I met Adri, I felt like I had known her my whole life, as if the mountain that separated my part of Kentucky from her part of Virginia was the only thing that had ever kept us apart. She's the kind of person who just takes you in, and she just loves you. She hugs you tightly, she looks you in the eye and really listens when you talk to her. She laughs with her head thrown back. I was lucky to be on the set of Big Stone Gap a couple of times, and watching her work is a masterclass in not only work ethic, but also grace, strength, and determination. She always makes me so proud to know her and to be from the same place as her. She is an inspiration. Adri is truly one of America's storytellers, and I'm so proud that we can call her one of our own. So please welcome Appalachian treasure, Adriana Trigiani.
Oh, thank you. Oh, Silas, you know, I'm trying not to cry because I really want to be professional, but I don't think anybody's ever said so many nice things about me. Like you, we do this because we understand that we're serving. So to everyone that I'm looking at tonight that I can see in the room there, and to anybody within the sound of my voice, please understand that as writers and as Appalachians, we are here for you. And I know that might be a little odd to hear, but I just want you to think about that, that you already have the network you need as writers to get your work out into the world, okay? So let's start with that. Now, you already have two names, and I know you've got my name and you've got Silas that you can appeal to, number one. But all the workshops that you took in this beautiful conference that we do every year. So let me begin by saying that everything that pertains to the American story started in Appalachia. Every piece of music, every idea about how to dramatize that theatrically, the idea of inclusion, the idea of art as a community effort, and writing and storytelling as this innate gift that is your responsibility to transfer to the page through the written word. See, it's your responsibility. And you might say, well, does anybody want to? Yes, they do. Yes, they do. And it's up to you to really focus on and think about, learned a lot in the last few days, but to really think about what do you want to say about what you come from and who you are. And do it with a particularity that is so streamlined that you then have a mission. So you might be saying to me, well, Adri, I have a day job and I got four kids, or I'm a widow, or I'm a widower and I'm depressed and I can't get this out, but I came to this hoping that I would be, listen to me, the way out is the writing. The way out is the writing. And I can cite so many examples of women who husband died, they got eight kids. Mary Higgins Clark put the typewriter on the table. Her first one kind of stunk. It was about George Washington, but then she started to find her voice. So when I say find your voice, your mission first, because your voice then will follow. If you know why you want to write, it isn't about getting published. That will come. The most important thing is to tell the story. Now, everybody's got one roiling around, I know, or maybe 10 or 12 or maybe 100. Pick the one through your subconscious, and I'll get to that in 2 seconds, that is telling you that now is the moment for that story. When a story is fresh, that's one way to do it. But boy, there's great stuff that you will mine from your past, or you can go back generations to your grandmother. You know, you have them. And you might say, well, why does anybody want to hear from me? Well, in all the history of the world, in all of humanity, there's only been one you. It might have been two of you. It ain't been eight of you. It ain't even been three of you. There's one. Through your eyes and the soul you inhabit is where the storytelling come from. Silas and I like agree on this one. It's a spiritual exercise, guys. It's not like trying to figure out what people want to hear. It's what your mission is. What are you trying to say? And you know, Appalachia, because I felt this when I went to Scotland, right? When Silas and I have talked about this. When you go back to where, and I say in specificity, your people come from, you begin to understand the Appalachian experience in a way that illuminates it. And by that I mean, your stories matter. So Scotland at the beginning of all the, in all the history, this is where the first bank was. That's, you follow the money, that's your country. The storytelling, the music, the dramatizations, the ability to, for stories to go through generations and people's stories to be remembered, stories of women, poetry of Robert Burns, I could keep going. How does that, what does that mean in terms of the American experience in Appalachia, where we're all immigrants? All immigrants. And how we got here, to Appalachia is a story of real daring and adventure. So it's in you already. It's like you don't even have to really scratch the surface. It's in you. It's deeply embedded in you. So when you define your mission and you decide what you want to be, what world you want to create, what you want the world to know about where you come from and the people that you come from. I say this, I mean, listen, there's a lot of places I haven't been, but the best people on earth are in Appalachia because they never want anything except the experience of the story. They just want you to sit on the porch and talk. They just want to tell you about their mamma. So when I say they, I mean us. So every bit of storytelling that I ever engage, I return to my Appalachian experience and say, okay, what is it? Because I always felt this about Appalachia. It had the ability to be a worldwide embracer and community, and has the ability to be extremely private and closed. Well, you need both to write a great story. You need that focus, that complete, utter focus about these people that you're writing about in your stories and your books. Because if you write those characters in the specificity as you know them, and believe me, I'm sitting here with the master, Silas House. But think about Barbara Kingsolver. Think about her specificity. Think about Lee Smith. I've come to look at her work like bunting, like those triangles they hang, you know, when there's a parade. They're all different, but they're all the same colors and the same sense of character. So when I say find your mission, the second thing I'm going to ask you to do is not to write, but to read. Read, read, read. Evidently, somebody's having a party in a car going by. If you can hear that, I can hear it. It's like booming in my house. But you want to read. And you might say, well, you know, I don't have a lot of time. You'll find out that you have time in these ways. Listen to audiobooks. Choose poetry. Make it a habit. And pretty soon you'll be plowing through doorstoppers and it won't even change your day. Even when you get to the point where you're being a published writer, the training that I had, having what I call my day jobs, all these hustles I had to do to just stay, keep my head above the water, that becomes the habit of your Appalachian storytelling. Then you're bringing that work ethic to it. So it isn't even a question of should I? It's you must. You've got to do it. And the fact that you came to this, it tells me everything that you came to this conference. I don't even have to ask you any questions about why you're there. You know why you're there. You were compelled and you were called, and that is the nature of being Appalachian. You are called to a mission, you deliver the mission, you make the statement, and nobody is going to tell the same story. So begin to look at your life now like, hey, now it's my turn. All of you sitting there, I can see y'all sitting there thinking, mm-hmm. You have to carve out the time. And people say to me, well, how do I do that? Because I got a job, I'm a teacher, I got to get to the thing. I said, you got to get up 2 hours earlier in the morning. Because at the end of the day, you don't have the energy. You may say, well, I'm a good night writer. Well, if you get up early, that's night. You see what I'm saying? Just 2 hours. You'll be sitting there with coffee going, she's out of her mind. The reason I'm telling you to do it first thing in the morning is because you've slept. And if you harness the power of your sleep, if you bring those Appalachian characters that you want to write about into your subconscious, and you say, what's going to happen to Caroline tomorrow morning? I got to have that notebook ready. I promise you it will be there for you. That's the divine. It's similar to prayer. It is similar to the meditative arts. It's similar to the mystery. I can't tell you where it comes from. I think it happens to be, in my relationship, I do think it's God, where this comes from. But God isn't going to give you like one daisy. He's going to kind of dump the whole thing on you. And you're going to have to sort. That's what I'm saying. If you know your mission, you'll be able to pick. So let's say, for the sake of our conversation tonight, that you want to write a novel. Here's the thing nobody tells you. It's a living, breathing world. It's not something that happened. When you're writing, it's happening. Just tell us, the reader, describe where you are. Why is your character there? What, you may know the arc of your story. Let that be on, you know, you can outline and have it on paper, but I'm going to encourage you to feel your way through it. You know who these folks are. You know what they need. You know what they want. Just tell it to me like you're telling me a story on a street corner. I have a quote here somewhere on my desk. I'm sorry, I dusted for you, and I might have moved it, but I can repeat it to you. Basically, the great Federico Fellini, who, by the way, wasn't an Appalachian, but he wrote about the experience of being an Italian boy in a small town, which you share with him, a child in a small town. Maybe you're from Knoxville, and to us, that was the big city. Wherever you're from, and you, Kentucky is like a, to me, I call it the pop-up state, because it unfolds like a story as you're driving through it. Take us there. Help us understand Tennessee, Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina. Some of you may have come from Georgia. Appalachia, they call it the American rainforest. It's the valuable place. It's the place of all value. And it's on you to bring us into that world. It's on you to be the Appalachian legacy. Now, there's another thing I'm thinking. I get people come up to me all the time and go, I just don't know if I can do it. Now, it could be somebody 20 or 18, or somebody 75 or 80. There's no age on the page. There's the characters and the world and the commitment and the mission. That's it. The great Frank McCourt taught school for 40 years, and he published Angela's Ashes when he was in his 70s and became the most acclaimed author on the planet because he wrote about the story of where he came from. It is the keys to your audience, to your readership, to your publisher, to your world. It's everything. I'm keeping this simple tonight because I hate to tell you it is simple. It's as simple as your determination to tell the story you were born to write. Put that on your desk. Say, what is the story I was born to write? You know, when you have a baby, you know what that mission is. You have to take care of it. You have to nurture it. You have to lead it by example. Well, same thing with your stories that you're creating. Any act of creativity is an act of God, but it's an act of your openness to take that gift and share it. Because there's only two things that go on this planet, creativity and destruction. And I don't think you want to be a part of the destruction or you wouldn't be here. You want to contribute to the conversation. Now, why is Appalachia essential? And why do I know for sure that it's essential? I'm looking at it. I'm looking at you. You must achieve your potential, your creative potential. The creative life is worth living. Even when you commit to that 2 hours in the morning, your life is going to start to change. Because you won't be scattered. It's very hard for any of us when we have to do other jobs, because believe me, I lived it and I know it. I used to resent my day jobs and be like, I got to get out of here. I got to write. Listen to me. 2 hours, an hour each day, within 6 months, you'll be finished with your first thing. Now, if you've already done it and you went, oh, I'm not that pleased with it, I want you to go back, open it on page one and go, and with this only thought in mind, am I fulfilling the mission that I set out to do? Silas and I, all the writers that you've met, we have things that we don't show people. We have things we started that didn't go anywhere. But when we found the lane, we stayed in it and we finished. So it's up to you to figure that out. Because I have no doubt the talent is there. I have no doubt the drive is there. It's what is the story and why would it matter to anybody anywhere else in the world? But back to Fellini. Fellini said, and this is why I became a director. I studied theater, but you know, listen, you've studied as much theater as me, okay? You have to have a worldview. You have to know how to communicate with people. And you have to know how to create the world, okay? They kept us out of it for years and years because it's expensive. It's an expensive art form. That's why the Origin Project was this and a piece of paper. That I knew I could come up with. That's why we're writers. Because if we were fancy, we'd be doing something else. Seriously. Because we know the power of this. And it doesn't, this costs what a pencil costs. And we can all afford that. Or we can find one somewhere. And you might be saying, Adrian, why are you talking about this economic model? Because it's everything. Your time is the money. Now, Fellini broke it down so easily. He said, don't be cowed by technique. Don't be cowed by somebody, fancy person or snobby person saying they know how to do it better. Don't be cowed by somebody who went to some fancy school. The greatest writers in the world didn't go to school. Start with Abraham Lincoln, and I could go back to the Greeks. They didn't go to school. They lived in the world. They knew their, and they made a decision about what they was burning inside them to tell you on the page. Don't go buy into that any of that insecurity stuff. It doesn't exist. Don't tell yourself you're not good enough. Don't beat yourself up. That's the antithesis of being Appalachian. Is it's the power center of storytelling. So, Fellini said, all you got to do, just tell me your story. Now, when he got a camera involved, all he did was show the world as he saw it. And now none of us have any excuses as storytellers when you do something visual, because digital is free. You want to know what happened 20 years ago? 20 years ago, the Kodak factory went out of business because it was $250 a foot. And when I made a documentary, you need $300,000 worth of stuff. Digital, I could do it now. And when I make them, that's why you see women directors now. They weren't letting us in. Frankly, they were not letting us in. You could do it. You can do it. Now, what did I have? And why did they let me do it? Because I had the story and the characters and the actors. I knew, if I believed in it, that another creative artist would believe in it. And let me tell you, when you know the power, they'll try to kill you. But then you're going to call me, and I'll talk you through it. Now, I don't want you to think any more about the world, publishers, literature, anything, as something out there. I want you to start to think about that as within you. It's inside you. My friend Anne Lamott says it's an inside job. It's all an inside job. You must not feel defeated. You must not feel that nobody cares about your stories. You must not feel any of that, because Frank McCourt, 40 years as a school teacher, took a shot. You got to take the shot. You have to manifest it in your life. You have to make it real. Okay, so I'm going to give you some specifics now on this. If you're trying to write, you know, while you're making dinner for your aging parents and the kids, right? Because I lived that life too. I've lived them all. Where you're trying to, you're pulled as a single person, as a married person, as a divorced person, as a, you know. But you have to say to yourself, no, this is my number one priority in terms of my mission. Love everybody, take care of everybody. But on that list somewhere, put you. So the first thing I always say is that get up 2 hours earlier. It at first you think it's going to kill my looks, but believe me, you adapt. You'll be fine. So you do that, but then you need a couple of other things. You need a sacred space to work. In your home, now you're going to laugh when I tell you this, but in New York, you would laugh in the tiny spaces we live in. I can tell you some of the greatest writers I know work in a closet. They move the coats, they put a little thing in it, and they put a thing. A place where they can close the door or even just be three-quarter surround. No distractions, no internet, no television, no music. Just get in there. Get in there. Your sacred space. Whatever instruments you, and you know, I get mad when people come, see, I keep it like this. And I get mad when people come in here and take my pens and use it, because my fingers tell me I know when somebody else to use my pen. So you're allowed to be an animal about your stuff. The notebook thing is really important. I wait. You kind of go, you know, Target or Walmart, they put them on sale. They're like 50 cents, but they're hardcover. I get them. I they're everywhere. When you're working on a book, surround yourself with books and work in a book. And then you can get it to the computer. If you're real fast and facile, okay, that's fine. Some people are doing it on their phone now. This phone to me is an albatross, so I can't even. But I like notebooks. You know what you like. You remember that feeling on the first day of school when you got a new notebook? Well, you get to live that as a grown-up. So equipment, sacred space. that nobody else touches. And I don't want you to be tempted in the notebook where you're writing your book or your idea for your book to put your laundry list down there or your, you know, your grocery list or got to call Uncle Dave. No. This is about the mission. Clear. And if you remember you have to go buy milk, get up and go make a list somewhere else, but don't do it in that notebook. And you're saying, why? Because the mission has to be clear. Clear. Can't be muddled. It can't be mixed up in all the other responsibilities you have. The 2 hours, the hour a day, some of you will do a half hour. You will see if you make yourself do it every single day. Okay, so now you have the sacred space. You have, which it could be the corner, it could be a corner in your kitchen. You guys, nothing fancy. That's the beauty of this career. There was nothing, now there's something. Now there's a book, now there's a story, now there's a play, now there's a screenplay. Okay, so now you've got your mission, you're focused, you know the story you want to tell. Then you must make the deal with yourself that you will not give up on that idea until you get to the end. People come up to me all the time and say, I'm a writer. I'm always thrilled. And then they say to me, but I just can't write. Can't get it. I can't do it. I can't write. So you know what I tell them? The idea is not ready yet. Because there's no such thing as writer's block. That's crazy talk. It just means that whatever it is you're trying to say isn't ready yet. And in that instance, you do your notebook, you do your thing, you write down, I'm figuring it out. But I bet you could do this. I bet if you see this character, Sally, who's the mama, you can describe her. Put it down. Some of us love music and we would like to write lyrics or poetry. That's called the diversion. It gets you into your story that way. Don't be afraid that it's not flowing, because it's not ready to flow yet. To unlock the river, you have to unlock your fear about doing it. The fear must go. So, well, how does the fear go? Write one page. You won't be afraid anymore. If you need backup on how do I work when I sleep, Get the Power of Your Subconscious Mind by Joseph Murphy, written during the Great Depression. It has sold 500 million copies. It's insane. You can get it used. I have several copies I've given to people who've died, and I inherit them back. If you can't find it, write to me. I'll make sure you get a copy. It teaches you how to harness that subconscious. You say, well, what is it? Well, you know, like when you have to, let's say you had to go to the conference and you had to get up early because you had to drive there. And you don't get up at 4 o'clock in the morning usually. You get up at 6 or 5 or something. And you set your phone next to you and you have the alarm clock and you call your friends and you tell your husband, wake me up. You know, has everybody experienced that? Raise your hand. Okay. Or you got to go somewhere. There's a flight or there's a bus trip or there's whatever. You got to get up earlier. Okay. You set all the bells all over the house. You cannot be late. You've got to get to the conference. And at 4:05, when the bells are about to go off, you wake up. Have you had that experience? When you've set the alarm and then you wake up before the alarm goes off. That's your subconscious. You told it, wake me up at 4:05. Well, I do that every single night. When I go to sleep, I go, well, I have a lose that the book won't be on. It's got hair and curlers. What happens? I go to sleep, I wake up with the answer. I use it to solve every problem I have. It leads me to the books I need to read. When we were filming Big Stone Gap, I had a horrible dilemma that was a creative one. And I was walking around my mother's house, and you know, my mother was a librarian, so there's a lot of books. And for some reason, I went down to the basement where my dad kept his books. Not a good place to keep your books, but I took them out of there, I have it. And I found a book by a producer in Hollywood. It was his autobiography with Mel Gussow, who was a great critic for the New York Times, and his name was Daryl F. Zanuck. You've seen all his movies. I just said, okay, I'm too tired, and I just opened the book, and I read. And there was my answer. Now, that does that sound crazy? It's not crazy when you do it all the time. You start to look to the world for the answers to your specific mission. So train your subconscious. And then the next thing I'm going to say is, once you're finished, go to the people that have shown an interest in you to read your material. One of the great things in Appalachia are the community colleges, the colleges you could go to. Let me tell you something. Even if you never applied to college or went to college, there are writing classes available to you and writing communities in the schools that you have never set a foot in. I'm going to keep going back to this. The great storytellers didn't have a bunch of fancy medals on where they went to school. They had a finished document that described perfectly the world they were trying to create and exceeded the mission that they had set for themselves. You see, in Appalachia, sometimes we think we're not good enough because we have been imprinted and told that. Well, I wasn't about to let that be my reality and truth, and neither did Silas, neither did Barbara. We don't think like that. In fact, we got our fight on and went, okay, you don't think we can do it? We'll show you. Silas had a mentor in our great Earl Hamner. Earl saw Silas's brilliance. Seek out mentors. If you want it to be me, I'm here for you. If you want it to be Silas, you want it to be Buck, just tell us. Nothing makes us happier than, and this is why we do the Origin Project, and we're giving them schools, and Silas does all his part. We get in there because we want the kids to understand you're not only worth it, you're amazing. And you come from those people. That stock, you know how we always say your people. Well, your people are magnificent. And by the way, not just your family. Think of the people you knew that encouraged you. Who's going to write the story of Friday Night Football in Appalachia? I don't count the Texas show. Texas. You know, to the world, it's like, that's the South. Well, not Appalachia. You have to do it. You must do it. So find that. Look, in terms of the support for you, it's there. You say, well, okay, let's assume I can do it. I'm hearing the naysayers. Well, let's assume I can do it. Who's going to care? When you write authentic, real characters in a world that you have created, who from page one to page 300 change, people around the world are interested. They're seeking, you understand that people read books because they're trying to understand this experience, because listen, it's a crazy hayride. But when you come from storytellers in a place that is rich, rich with stories that have not been told, you empower yourself. You empower yourself with your God. It not only be understood, but to be revered. I mean, the acts of grace, courage, adventure, of love from going inside the earth for the coal to processing it to the lumber industry, to think of the seamstresses that you know in Appalachia. We can't have enough books or insight or even just little sidebars about their creativity. The food, the sustenance, the herbs that grow in the earth, the kilns that make the moonshine, the ability, you know, people say to me all the time, where'd you get the guts to do that? Where I grew up, if you had a slight ability in anything, if you didn't get up and do it, you know you're Appalachian. If you had a talent, you were in the marching band or you did this or you did, they made you do it. Get up and sing. You could sing. And look to the great artists that come from our neck of the woods. I mean, you could go back in time, you know, John Fox Jr., you could look at the folks. One of my favorite books is a little pamphlet written by a coal miner's wife. The small town newspapers, which you have access to. Okay, so now I've told you, if you got your thing, you got it. If you don't have your mission and you're not really clear and you're like, I know I can do it, I just don't know what the story is, go to the archives of your small town newspaper. Some of the greatest writing ever, and some of our greatest novelists were journalists. The small town newspaper is our treasure. Read one obituary. I try to do it every day. I read the obituaries because, wow, what a life. There is no end to the ideas once you make the decision that you're on your mission. Because once you tell your story, can I tell you something? I don't care if your words are misspelled or you don't know where to put your comma, it doesn't matter. If it's rich and it's original and it's wholly from you, the likes of you who was never born before and will never be again, people will read it. And if your Appalachian experience is just like, let's just say it's the veil on the bride, that's the thing that flows. Use that image. If you're a man, I don't know what you use, but something. Tell the stories and always talk about Appalachia. Always talk about it. Talk about Appalachia. Because you'll be surprised what you learn that you thought you knew. If you are at the end of this conversation that we're having, still afraid, the first thing in that notebook, the first line in it should be, I have to overcome this fear. Because I'm a storyteller, period. As your subconscious begins its glorious unfolding within you, you didn't know what it was because basically like an origami thing, it's like teeny tiny. We want to unfurl it. We want you using it for everything. Believe me, I have few skills. But one of them is, I can always tell you what time it is, and I don't wear a watch. Never did. Subconscious. I can kind of go, yeah, I think it's, it's after 8 o'clock. You have those gifts and more, better, different. And you cannot, waste time. You can't do it. You guys, you can't waste time. You don't know how much you've got. You don't know when you have to drop everything to go take care of somebody. You don't know if your boss has ended up the hot, you got to do all his work or her work. All I know is I feel pretty good right now. I better get my work done. Don't kick the can down the road. You know, my grandmother, we badgered her to write down her life story. And of course, you know, she didn't. And we got her those books. It says, you know, Grandma remembers or whatever. Nothing was filled in. And I was going through her recipes. I don't know if you remember, there was a store called the Ben Franklin. My grandmother killed me. She saved paper, you know, like the wax paper out of cereal boxes. You know, having grown up in Appalachia, you know these women that save tin foil and wash it and reuse it. That's my grandmother, but she was Italian. Going through this cookbook, and I opened it, and there was one of those Ben Franklin things, and I thought, why would she save like the cardboard from the Ben Franklin thing? And I opened it. And it said, the story of Yolanda Perrin Trigiani. And in two pages, she told her life story in her beautiful penmanship. She went to the eighth grade, before she went into a factory to work at the age of 14. It's one of the most beautifully written documents I've ever seen. Talked about where she was born and the farm upon which she was raised and where she fell in her family and where her parents came from, and that there was a creek and a tree and this beautiful, simple description. Now, she was daunted to write that. I know she was scared. And you know, I just thought of this. It was just two pieces of that Ben Franklin, those, you know, those flip toppers, and it's like glued in there. I wonder how many of the pages that came before she kept rewriting this. Probably hundreds. You don't want to take anything for granted, including time. St. Bernard of Clairvaux said this about the past. He said, if you want eternal life, heed these warnings. Now, to me, the bouquet of eternal life is earned by the purpose you were born to fulfill. If you say to me, oh, Adrian, I don't have the strength, come back. Silas will do another workshop. All the people that are scared, we'll do a scared workshop, okay? I'll be happy to lead it, interactive. But you have to think about time. So St. Bernard of Clairvaux said, if you want eternal life, heed these warnings. Three things in the past. The evil done. The good left undone, and this was the big one, the time wasted. Now, the time wasted haunts all of us. It haunts me. I guarantee you it haunts all my writer friends. It haunts us. Because we sometimes go, did I get it done? Did I get it done the way I wanted to? You know, my friend Amor Toll said, I said to him, but Amor wrote The Rules of Civility, the gentleman from Moscow, and he has a new one out that's going to come out called The Lincoln Highway, which is so our people, I can't even tell you, except they're Midwestern, but it felt Appalachian to me. I said to him, Amor, you're top of your game. He said, I need to write more books. I'm going to run out of time. So understand you're not alone. And understand that if that's your motivator, that's a good one. And I know if you're a woman, you're saying, oh, you know. Because women, we're the most put upon people on earth. We really are. And if we're women of color, it's worse, okay? I always say that to my girlfriend. But you can't use it as an excuse, because we built this civilization too. And these stories are important. And I know it pleases Silas and it pleases me when we see women on, it's a woman's game. And the men do great. But again, we're kind of the waft and weave of the whole industry. The publicists, the editors, publishers, the authors, the idea people, the designers, a lot of women. So you have no, there's nothing to be afraid of there. They want to see you make it. I want you to hold precious who you are. And not the terrible things that have happened to you, not the bad things, but the pure essence of who you are, of the mission of your soul, and the commitment to your intellect, which is reading. That's all it is. Not anything fancy. You know, I tell you this because for me, the Appalachian experience is one of the most important ones, is don't be stuck up. And I mean, you remember when you were in school, and if you missed saying hello to somebody, you heard about it in study hall. A friend Fletch used to report to me, you didn't say hello to so-and-so. Say hello. That same gene that we possess, or proclivity, where, you know, okay, you know how to play that instrument, play it. And you have to play that instrument, or you have to sing, or if you have a good speaking voice, didn't they make you get up and read in church? Of course, get up, because you can pronounce those words. You remember this. Don't forget it, because that's Appalachia. There's nobody else in the world like that. Nowhere we go. Even back to the old countries. But here, get up and do it. That's why we do the conferences, because we know that's part of our mission. That's part of our mission, to get you going. And, you know, the strength of purpose in the Appalachian people is unparalleled. And yet, we're not treated well. I happen to believe that the more powerful you are, the more they want to bring you down. When we're talking about kindness and acceptance and the ability to shift lanes and the ability to grab onto new ideas, it's Appalachian. When it comes to street smarts, and I was so happy to prove it when Silas came and we were making Big Stone Gap, you saw the street smarts. Well, this doesn't work. How are we going to do it? We're going to do this. The creativity, the ability to be facile on your feet. How can somebody who's the Batcher in the Pepsi plant in Norton, Virginia, act in a movie? I knew we could. And he kept saying, do you really think I did it? Yeah, Ricky, you can do it. And I still have the audition tape on my phone. Yeah, I didn't make him read. I said, Ricky, what's your favorite movie? He said, The Wizard of Oz. And then he told me why. He told me about The Wizard of Oz like if I was a Martian coming from some other planet, since that's going to be possible very soon, evidently. He explained it. And as he was explaining, I went, that's this script. It's an Odyssey story. And there's four of them. The great Ashley Judd played. And by the way, you want an Appalachian in your movie. They can work the hours and they've got the creativity, but they also have the know-how. True movie star, Patrick, Theodore, And then I'd have to say the fourth one was Speck, Tony LaPaglia. I do these four lives. I'm going to go like this. John Benjamin Hickey. But the idea of an odyssey. So when Ricky said it, I kind of went, oh, that's important for me to think about. Sometimes it's just asking yourself the question. It's this simple. What kind of books do I like to read? When you ask yourself that question, it's going to unlock what you're going to write. Or you're going to look at the manuscript you did write and go, this isn't really me. Put it in a drawer. It can be the second book you publish. And get to work on the one that fills your heart. It's a spiritual exercise. So you have to call on your spirit. And no matter where you come from, what I love about authors, Silas Obeck, no two look alike. Like there's no postage stamp. Oh, that's what an author is. It's you. That's what a writer is. It's you. You telling me the story. So tomorrow, I mean, when the conference is over, try the simple step. You know what, laundry room. Now I'm in this room. But for 17 years, I wrote book after book in the laundry room. Because it's the only room we had to do it. So don't let anything deter you. And I have one final piece of advice. Don't tell anybody what you're writing. Don't talk about it, unless you're in class. Because the obstacles around us sometimes short-circuit us and scare us and make us not do the work. You know what I'm talking about. The people in your life who've told you can't do something for all your life. The people that love you but can't support you, they're just scared. Because not only do they not want to achieve their purpose, they don't want you to either. You know who they are. So just know, you know, just move along. Love them, be their friend, but the work, got to start treating the work like it's sacred. Because it happens to be sacred. So now I imagine there are some questions, right, Silas?
Yes, we have a few questions, and I think I speak on behalf of everybody and just... as much as we appreciate this technology, we wish we could all be together so we could be holding you and giving you a standing ovation. This was so moving and inspirational, and I just can't thank you enough for everything you've said. So many of us need to hear it. You know, that kind of inspiring talk, we always need to hear that. No matter how many books we published, if we publish 0 or 15 or whatever, we always have to remind ourselves of those things. So thank you so much, Adri, for
please. And I look forward to being in person when we can do it.
We can't wait to get you on campus sometime.
Can't wait. It'll be fun.
Well, Jack Wright is from Southwest Virginia, and he wanted to know, I love this question. I always love being asked this question. He wanted to know if you had a teacher who was especially somebody who influenced you or encouraged you.
Okay. The question actually makes me emotional. My first teacher is my mother, and she was a librarian. So you start with her. And then 1 year of a little school in Rosetta, Pennsylvania called Our Lady of Mount Carmel, and Sister Teresa Kelly. we were drawing the nativity, and I drew crisscrosses on the swaddle of the baby, because I come from a big family and seen it. And she tapped me on the shoulder and she said, "Someday you will be a great artist." That stayed with me.
Right.
Then, get ready. In Big Stone Gap, Virginia, Big Stone Gap Elementary School, Mrs. Thelma Carter, Mrs. Grace White, Mrs. Elizabeth Callahan, Mr. Basil Walker, Mrs. Arlene Sharp, and I can keep going. Every single one of my teachers had a profound impact on me. In high school, Francis Lewis, Teresa Bledsoe, who was my French teacher, 3 years of French, and I can't even order a croissant. Okay, but she taught us culture with the language, see. My high school algebra teacher, you know, I never got above a C, Coach Burl Pei, and he was made of something. You know, like he was a winning basketball coach, but there's something going on inside that guy's head. I would just kind of study him. Mm-hmm. He'd talk about great books with us. We were in math class. What's that about?
Right.
So I, you know, but the experience of school was so fascinating because, you know, you learned not only to have the Appalachian experience, but to celebrate it. Mm-hmm. So yes, my teachers.
Yes, me too.
Can't you picture, like Elizabeth Callahan, I could tell you what she wore every day. Grace White was turned out. I mean, but there's the reverence. And the other thing I want to say about my teachers is, we were there after integration. And I have conversations about this all the time. Where is the celebration of the people of color? Because if you have ever been to an African-American wedding or into an African-American home for dinner or were taught by an African-American, you revere that culture. You revere it. That makes me a little nuts.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't true in my town. I didn't see it in that way. I saw it, the great possibilities.
That's great. Great to hear. And I think that really comes through in the film, especially Big Stone Gap and book. But you get to see it in such a different way in the film, and it's so rare to be seen in a film about rural people and small town people. So
you were so kind to write about it. Silas, you were such a champion of that movie. And you know, it's available. People can watch it anytime.
Yes, look for it. Well, I'm going to ask one more question. I think we have maybe one or two in the room at Hyndman, but I'm sorry we won't be able to get to all the questions on Facebook. But Sharon Phillips asked, she says, "Also, living in rural East Tennessee, I found myself a little fearful of some content I may be emphasizing in my writing.
Oh.
How does one combat this and the fear of communal or familial backlash?"
Well, if you're writing about your family, just change the hair color.
Right. Yeah.
If it's a tall man who's bald, make him 5'4 with blonde, thick blonde hair. They never think it's them.
Yeah, and usually if somebody's the bad guy, they don't recognize themselves.
They never do. They think they're the hero, always. Right. But you know, there's another great thing. Look, you must not be afraid to tell the truth. But here's the thing. Put it down, and Silas will tell you this. Some of that stuff we wrote, we never put it in the final book, but we get it out.
Right. Sure.
You'll know, like, I couldn't write a thriller because they scare me. Okay? Now, could I study it, you know, and then try to do it? Maybe. All right. Well, again, the time thing. You know, I'd rather write what I want to write. But you'll find your voice, but it comes from those notebooks. And then it comes from typing it in, or if you don't type, learn, or to have somebody type it for you, so that you can see what a book would look like. And then you'll read it, and you know, sometimes you'll write something that you're distanced from, Don't be afraid of that. And if it's that, if you feel like what you're going to write is about where you're living in East Tennessee, but you'd rather set it in Georgia. Now the Georgians will write me letters, but set it somewhere else.
Yeah.
Set it somewhere else. There, you know, if it's that, you know, if you think, but I'm going to tell you, it's probably not as devastating as you think. Unless it's you're naming some living person who, you know, broke up with you and, you know, you'd like to never see him again. But if it's, be creative with that.
Yeah. Let go of the fear, right?
There's no reason to have fear.
Right.
And I will tell you right, I came up with this last week, Silas, this is sticking, and I'm old. And I'm looking and I'm going, oh. It finally dawned on me. I'm like, because I do this Facebook Live show with authors and I love them. And maybe once I had somebody on that I thought I wouldn't like them. I have made a commitment to myself to let go of that stuff. And didn't I loved him. Now, how's that possible? And I'm going to say this too is also the Appalachian experience is our Hatfield and McCoy's thing, but we have it going on inside of us, the battle all the time for dominance, right? It's in us. Well, that's just about you haven't decided yet.
Right.
And when people are snobby or stuck up, as we used to say back home, they're just insecure. And we don't have any room for any insecurity in this process that we are on in our writing. There's no room for that.
Right.
That's right. You're going to lean on other writers.
Right. Yeah. Well, we are out of time, but I want to, I didn't mention this in the intro, but I want to make sure that people know about Adriana Inc. It's the world's biggest book club. And tune in. It's every Thursday at 7. Is that right, Adri?
Every Tuesday on the pub date at 6. You were close. No, I did yours on a Thursday. Because right. Sometimes I'll do two or three a week because I want to get to everybody. But, yeah, we have to have you back, Silas, because we want to have a big conversation one.
Well, Adriana interviews, talks, has conversations with some of the best writers in the world, not just in the country. And they're just some of the best conversations about writing you'll ever hear. So check those out. And if you can't watch them live, they're
on YouTube. You can see them on YouTube, so you can pick your favorite writer.
Right. Well, again, I can't thank you enough. I just wish that you could receive all the love that everybody...
I feel it.
Okay.
I'm feeling it.
Good. Well, thank you all so much. I'm going to turn it over to Josh Mullins. And he's going to say a few words and close us down for this year's workshop. Thanks again to everybody out there for being here. And thanks especially to Adriana for this wonderful talk. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Go get them, everybody.
Adriana, let's give her one more round of applause for having such an inspiring.
I can hear it.
Hopefully. And thank you to Silas for all the work that you've done this week. We wish you'd been here with us, but we will see you soon. And one more thank you to Teresa for coming out tonight and for representing Mr. Still and for the legacy that he has here at Heinlein and for the Appalachian writing community. So thank you all. Just a few quick things before we depart for the night for evening activities and to a few things. Adriana sent four beautiful gift packages of signed books with some fun. I don't know. This one even has a Piggly Wiggly oven mitt with it. And so with Home to Big Stone Gap and with her cookbook, she has an apron. And with Tony's wife, there's some other fun things as well. So we have a drawing, as we've been doing all week. So we want to send these home. Hopefully some of the people in the room win and some out in the world win too. So Jordan's going to come up and we'll pull four names out for that. So again, thank you to Adriana for doing this for us. And so, Jordan, who is taking home Tony's wife?
Mallory Graham.
Nice.
Mallory Graham. I don't think she's here with us in person, so we will send this to Mallory. Jordan will put that name tag on it so I don't forget. For the home to Big Stone Gap with the Piggly Wiggly oven mitt. My name's not in there, so I'm sad. Because I love this oven mitt.
Linda McAuliffe.
Linda McAuliffe? Yeah, so this we're double dosing. We did have, Adrian, this evening, we cooked from your cookbook tonight. So we had lasagna and we had the buttermilk cake.
Oh my God, my sister Mary's gonna be on fire. You had the buttermilk cake?
We had the buttermilk cake, the lasagna, and Nancy's chopped salad.
Nice.
Yeah, so that was dinner tonight. So an apron and a cookbook, and Jordan's gonna pull somebody that's not won something already this week now. So, yeah.
Patty Miller
will receive this. And now all the people in the room are upset waiting for someone here on campus to win something tonight. So it is Jordan who you will direct your anger to, not Josh.
Put a lot of pressure on.
Last one. Again, this is for life lessons from my grandmothers.
Oh, yeah, that's a good one.
With a Maggi craft kit.
Yeah, like you, it's a vase.
Vase, yeah. Come on, Jordan, you can do it. Jenny McDaniel, so he is getting hate mail. There you go. We will get those to those winners. Thank you all for that. A few other quick things I will say is we do want to thank everyone for being a part of the workshop this year. We hope that you found it valuable and insightful and uplifting and empowering, and that you leave energized and ready to tell those stories and with this great advice that Adriana gave us this evening about making that possible. We do want to just remind you that there are other opportunities to be engaged in the writing community here at Hindman throughout the year. We will have Makery, our online courses. Those will launch in August, the registration. We have three wonderful courses this fall. Karen Salyer McElmurray will be leading a class on Writing Wonder, which is a look at writing joy in difficult times. Jane Waldrop will teach a class on It's Never Too Late to Start Writing Your Life. And Maryam Worthington will be doing a class on persona as poetry. And so those will be in September, October, and November. They're about 3 weeks each. And so we invite you in August to visit HindmanMakery.org and learn about those. I'm excited to tell you that we do have registration now open for our Fall Writers Retreats. And we will have two of those on the same weekend. We're bringing two facilitators in. And one of them is our very own Silas House. We'll be facilitating on a writer's retreat. I think it's his first time doing a retreat. And so we're excited to welcome Silas. And those are kind of small, I should say, and the other writer's retreat will be facilitated by Ashley Blooms. So we'll have two wonderful authors with us. And we invite you to come back on the weekend of November 12th. For a two-night experience here on campus. Those are not quite as structured, not as formal. They're smaller, intimate gatherings. But we are doing two of them, and they'll be shared meals together, but then you'll kind of seclude away to your own spaces depending on which workshop you choose to be a part of. So the registration is open now on Hindman.org for our two writers' retreats this fall. And again, if you can't join us that weekend, look again in the spring. We do these in the spring and the fall. So, and if you are a part of the workshop this evening, you're going to receive an email from me with information about completing an evaluation. We want to know what you thought and what we did well and how we can make this experience even more directed towards your needs in the future. So thank you all so much for being a part. Again, thank you to Silas and Adriana and Teresa for being a part of our evening tonight. And we will see you all very soon.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Great.
We'll see you soon.
We'll see you real soon.
I hope so.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye, everybody.
Are we off? Okay.